Hello, and welcome to PolyToots. This tutorial will be a short series with two goals. The first is to introduce people to Blender, and the second is to help existing game artists transition to it by focusing on some of the more need-to-know aspects when starting out. This particular video is all about the basics, while we get some reference set up. You could skip it if you're not a beginner, but you know, who knows, maybe you'll miss something cool. In the next videos, we'll pick up the pace and dive more into modeling, UVs, and texturing. Okay, so the very first thing you're going to want to do is navigate the 3D space. Don't worry about all these menus and buttons, we will get to those when we need them. For now, focus on the middle mouse button. It will orbit around your object. Holding shift while pressing it will pan, and holding control instead will zoom. You can also scroll your mouse wheel for this, obviously. As a bonus, holding alt, pressing the middle mouse button, and then flicking the mouse in a specific direction will switch you into a different orthographic view, which is, you know, pretty cool. If you're transitioning to Blender from other 3D software and just can't get used to any of this, my advice is to go tweak the navigation and key map categories from the preferences menu. I can't tell you what to change, obviously, as it's personal preference, but I will say to only change key maps that are related to navigation. If you start customizing too much, you're not going to be able to follow most tutorials. Let's remove everything here by pressing A to select all and then X to delete. And now let's add our reference in the scene. So with Shift and A on the keyboard, we can access the Add menu. It's also up here in the top bar, but you'll want to get used to hotkeys sooner rather than later. So that's Shift A, and then we'll navigate to Image, Mesh Plane, and it will prompt us to choose an image. I'll include a link in the description for you to get the same schematic that I'll be using. The reason we're using the mesh plane option instead of anything else is that all of our angles for this are on the same image, so we can stick it on an actual mesh and then just slice that up instead of having to import multiple images. We can't see the image that we've selected yet, and that's because of the shading mode we're in. Blender has four of these, which you can change either up here in the top bar or by pressing Z. Material view will allow us to see our texture, but it actually makes sense for us to stay in solid view and instead go up here to the viewport shading dropdown and change the color category over to texture instead of material. Doing this instead of switching to material view gives us access to a few visual features that will help during modeling. The first being able to cull the back faces of geometry, which we can do by selecting this little dropdown in the top right and selecting backface culling. If you check this item menu over here on the right, which you can toggle with the N key, you'll see that our plane has these dimensions on the X, Y, and Z. Working to a real-world scale is a great habit to get into, especially for exporting assets into game engines and whatever else. With this in mind, and knowing that this entire image is just 1 meter across, we can safely assume that we need to scale it up. I do already know that this Jeep is about 3.3 meters long, so I'm going to add a cube into this scene and scale it to help me out. So let's Shift and A again, Mesh, and now we'll add a cube. We can tap the S key and drag the mouse to scale in all dimensions, or we can press an axis direction after we tap the S to lock it to that axis. So like S and then X, and now we're locked on the X axis. Just click that mouse whenever you're done. The same goes for grabbing and rotating, which is G and R respectively. It can all be access locked. Changing the scale of just one axis has given us a non-uniform scale, which in the world of 3D is something to be avoided as it can cause all sorts of problems with sculpting, texturing, modifier behavior, or even export oddities. We won't get into this too much right now, but it will likely come up again in the modeling video. So hit Control and A this time to open up the Apply Transforms menu. Choose Scale, and now you see our scale is reset back to 1, but the dimensions are still what they were after we scaled it. We can't actually see our image anymore, and that's where X-Ray comes into play, which you're going to be using a lot, by the way, so the hotkey for this is Alt and Z. If it's not behaving the same way for you, then you're likely in Material View instead of Solid View. Toggle for this is up here next to the shading views, but again, hotkeys, super important. So with S to scale and G to grab, I'm going to just eyeball this top view here so it lines up with the box on either side. You may have heard me talking about doing things in object mode, and there's a reason for this. Blender has multiple modes that you can work in. Object mode is like the top layer. You don't do any modeling in this mode. And right now we do need to go deeper. We need to slice this plane up and move each angle where we need them. So, edit mode. With the plane selected, we can go up here to change over, or you simply press the tab key to toggle between edit and object mode. The main thing we need to quickly talk about are verts, edges, and faces, which you can change up here or simply press 1, 2, or 3 while in edit mode. It sounds self-explanatory, and to be fair, it probably is, but just to throw caution to the wind, vertex mode allows you to select and transform verts, edge mode is the same but for edges, and face mode is also the same but for faces. You'll notice that the menus over here on the left have changed as well, and if by some oddity you don't have those, then you've accidentally pressed the T key, which will slide this menu in and out, so you know, T, 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 T. We don't need to cover these one by one, we'll eventually be using the most common as we progress, but the one we'll look at right now is loop cut. If you hover over many buttons in Blender, you can often find the hotkey. In this case, loop cut is on Control and R, so press Control and R. And then hover over an edge. You'll notice a new edge is highlighted. Click once to place the edge in like the dead center, and then if you need to, move the mouse to move that edge. Click again to accept. If you didn't want to move the edge after first adding it, you can just right click and it will keep it in the middle. We'll keep doing this until we've got all of our angles in sections that we can just pop out. Now we need to separate them into their own objects, so we'll press the number 3 key to go into face mode, select the face, and press the P key. It will open up a little menu, and the one we want is selection, meaning to separate the selection we've just made. You can also find this and more in the mesh menu up here. It will also remind you of the hotkey. So just keep doing this until you have all of the selections as their own object. One thing I noticed whilst slicing up the reference is we've clipped a bit of this side view, and if I just grab its edge and try to move it, it will stretch the whole image. This is normal behavior, but not the behavior that we need. I'd like to be able to extend my edge and get back bits of the image that have been cut off. We do this by coming over to this options dropdown in the top right and selecting correct face attributes. Strange name, but you know, whatever. Now we can move our edge and the image is being retained. We've also been left with this extra piece of reference, and we don't really need it, so press tab to hop back into object mode. And again, just for clarity, you can double check what mode you're in from up here. Then select this dud, press X, delete, bye bye. We can check out the outliner now, which is Blender's hierarchy, and you'll notice we've got a bunch of new objects here. Let's tidy this up a bit by renaming each one. You can either double click or hit F2 to rename things. F2 also works in the 3D view with any object that you have selected. And now let's tidy this up even more by moving all of our reference planes to a new collection. We can either right click in the outliner and create a new collection, or hold shift and select all the planes, and then hit M to move them. We can select an existing collection or make our own and everything gets moved automatically. Lastly, we just need to rotate and position these references. And now's a good time to mention that Blender does have regular move, scale, and rotate gizmos if you're into that. You can select them on the left panel. You'll notice that the selection point of our object is a little offset. This is because it's still using the origin point from the plane we sliced these images out of. We can fix this easily though, simply select all the objects. Then come up here to the object menu, set origin, origin to geometry. And when you see this little window pop up down the bottom, make sure the center is set to bounds center. This just checks the boundaries of each object and then puts the origin in the center of it. And if you have no idea what I mean when I say origin, this is basically the pivot point. That's what Blender calls the pivot point anyway, and not origin. And if you don't know what a pivot point is, I can't help you. Okay, so now we're all good, and what we've just done there is a super common thing to do, but you'll notice that there's no hotkey associated with that, which is fine, like they can't all be winners. We can add it to our own quick favorites though. The hotkey for this is Q, and if you press it, it will tell you that you need to right click on buttons to add them, So let's right click that origin button we just used and add it to the quick favorites. Now we can use this whenever we want by calling the menu with Q. For rotations, you can either switch to the gizmo and hold Control to snap it to 5-degree increments, or become a proper Blender user and press R for rotate, Z for the axis lock, and then just hold the Control key while moving the mouse. Or you can just type in the degrees that you want, like 90, for example. If it's the wrong way, just press the minus key, and that will turn it into a minus 90 rotation instead. And I think that about does it for the first video. This may seem like a bit of information overload, but don't worry about it. Like, you're not supposed to just get it after watching a video. You need to sit and try and make mistakes and angrily Google things and then hate yourself for how simple it actually was all along. It's a journey. Like, you know, we've all had to do it. And if you're up for it, we can keep going together. That's like my subtle way of saying smash that like button, subscribe and whatnot. What else do people do these days? I don't know. I'll see you in the next one though, yeah?